I've been a cop for about 20 years now, a little over 20. And I work north side a little bit, south side a lot of it. And I'm part of also the tactical response unit. We respond to the Trump rallies and the SB-1070s. So when you saw that man and all that mess going on, yeah, I was there. So that's when we get called out and stuff. But currently I'm assigned to the academy. I teach our officers to respond to this stuff. That's my whole thing. So a few years back, probably about 2.5, 3 years ago now, my sergeant at the time, he called me up and said, hey, I'm getting a lot of phone calls about active shooter training. Do we have anything put together? And I said, well, we train our guys in this. I said, well, yeah. He goes, no, I'm talking about businesses. I said, no. He said, because all we do is train officers. So he said, can you put something together? I said, yeah, sure. So for about the past 2.5 years now, 3, I've been going around and doing this. Sergeant that was with me, he retired already, so good for him. But yeah, active shooter. That's kind of the definition that we go off in law enforcement. Everybody's got their own definition of an active shooter. FBI likes numbers, so they'll put a number to it when it comes to how many people get killed, how many people get shot. So in all reality, it's somebody actively engaged. That's what you're taking out of that definition right there. Somebody who's actively engaged in killing or attempting to kill somebody. So don't get it confused with mass shootings and stuff like that, because that's a little bit different only because of different numbers. Because already this year, we're up to, I want to say 264, I think it is, mass shootings in the U.S. But that just means that there was somebody trying to shoot some crowd or something like that. Not everybody died. Some people got wounded. Some people didn't. So it's just that they classify it when it's a group and shots are being thrown at them. Okay. You guys remember this? Columbine? Most people remember where they were when this kind of stuff happened. This was a big thing as far as the nation and as far as law enforcement goes, because back then we were told back in 99 that when stuff like this happens, you don't have the vest, you don't have the armored vehicles, you don't have the rifles, you don't have the training to go and deal with those type of guys. So because you're patrol officers, you need to stay outside, lock it down, keep them in a box and just watch them show up and they're going to take care of it. Well, this happens. We saw this thing develop on national TV. We saw kids coming out of second story windows. We saw a whole lot of cops waiting outside too for hours. Now, it's not their fault. The reason it's not is because, like I said, they were told to stay outside. Wait for your SWAT team to show up. Downside to where they're at is Jefferson County up there. They have what's called the regional SWAT team. Now, that's like taking officers from Phoenix, Mesa, Tempe, Glendale, Scottsdale. All of the places say, all right, you guys are a SWAT team. Anything that happens in the metro area, you guys respond to. So you can imagine the drive time from East Mesa, them doing training, a search warrant or something, and then something kicks off at West Glendale. They have to respond. That drive time, that's kind of what these guys face. Because the first SWAT officer to show up on scene took them an hour to get there. So, and that goes along with their armored vehicles and everything else. So it changed the way we do things. Once that happened, the nation, we all looked at it as law enforcement and said, that can't happen again. We can't sit up there and just let this develop. So what we started doing is we started bringing in our guys and we started telling them, right, hey, remember when we used to tell you in your career that you guys had to stay outside? Yeah, you guys should go inside. And mind you, we got guys 10, 15, 20 years on. And they're looking at us now. They're giving us the look like we have something going out of our forehead, telling them that you're now going to go in. So we told them, well, we're not just going to throw you guys to the wolves. We're going to give you the training. So we started training our guys in SWAT team jackets. Then after that, we started slowly developing our equipment. So now we've got rifles. We've got ballistic shields. A lot of us have gone out and we've got our own Kevlar helmets and our own Kevlar plates to stop rifle rounds. Even more so on top of that, now it's current, is that we're giving our guys medical training to how to pack wounds, using chest seals, tourniquets, that kind of stuff. Our department only issues tourniquets. That's all they give. Our guys go out and we buy other stuff that we know how to use. You guys look up the hospital that got shot and so on, go up north. A chest seal saved his life. And that's not something we issue. Something these things obviously aren't only associated with schools anymore. Yeah, the school brought it to light, Columbine did, but they're no longer associated. In fact, these things have gone on for years, even way before Columbine happened. These things have been happening. If you think about the 1960s, the Bell Tower shooting in Texas, active shooter, these things go back even further. So it's not like it's anything. It's just it's happening now, and social media and the media out there are picking it up and they're putting it out there. So that's what's making the difference here. But these things can happen anywhere. So stuff that I talk about today, when I start talking about personal safety, doesn't mean that you can just use it just for work. You can use this in your everyday life. So that's one of our charts. The way stats work is they'll compile them, and then years later we end up getting them. So if this is an older chart, but it still holds true as far as where these things are happening. Commerce, that's kind of the high value targets for the fact that there's a lot of people there, and generally people aren't armed. So when these guys start planning it out, it's a minimum of 7 days usually that they've been planning these things out. But they go, they scout, and they know that place isn't going to have armed security. It's going to be a lot of people there, so a target-rich environment for them. Because these guys aren't your normal, everyday average criminals. They're not your drug dealers. They're not your gang bangers. They're nothing like that. These guys are separate. They're a different breed. In fact, some of these guys don't even have criminal records and even none of this. So when they say, well, how did that guy get all those guns? Well, that's because he never had a criminal record. So it may be easier for them. But they look for those types of places where people are going to be complacent and it's going to be a target-rich environment for them, because what they want is a high number of body count. That's what they want. Okay. Oh, before I go on, let me throw this out there. Has anybody been in one of these situations before? Know somebody who has? Okay. I don't know if it'll apply to you or not, but when I talk about this stuff, there's even a video here. A training video, but those things are kind of triggers. The last one I did, it was for one of our city human services, and I didn't know this, but one of our employees was involved in one of our active shooters downtown, so it hit her and she had to leave. So if any of this affects you at any point in time, feel free to leave. You're not going to hurt my feelings. Just want to throw it out. Okay. Also, I like to keep it light. If you guys have any questions at any point in time, shoot them up. Okay, I'll shoot you straight. I'm used to talking to a room full of cops, so I've been known every once in a while. My language has gotten colorful, but I know my audience, so I've been doing good for the past 2.5 years. I've done these for everybody almost, you know, churches and stuff. I really didn't watch my language yet. So it's serious as a topic as this is. Like I said, I like to keep it light, because what I don't want to do is I don't want to freak you guys out to the point where you get out of here and you go to your cubicle and start barricading it somewhere. Okay. That's what I don't want. Okay. Can't let them win, right? Another slide, that just 40 incidents, talking about people that were killed. Again, when I threw out that 260 some odd number, that's mass shootings. These are ones that have people that have been killed. So where did they mostly happen at? Generally open to the public. And again, no security, no lockdown, none of that kind of stuff, no metal detector, none of that stuff applied in these cases, because they didn't have them. Because if it was up to me, everybody would have some type of security all over the place, especially places like this, hospitals, that kind of stuff. Just for the fear of fact that people walk around with it, it's terrible. So these things are gonna end in one of three ways. Gonna commit suicide, like Columbine. Yeah, that suicide pact did everything they did, and then they committed suicide. They're gonna fight us and lose. San Bernardino, okay, they got pinned down. A lot of people don't know this about San Bernardino, but when they left after doing what they did the first time, they were driving back and forth in front of that building. They were trying to set off a remote bomb with their cell phone. They were just too stupid to figure it out, so can't see. A lot of lives in that aspect. Got spotted, fought it out with law enforcement, they lost. And then getting apprehended. Parkland, this shooting that happened not too long ago there in Florida, that high school. That kid did everything he did and then tried funneling out with the students. So somebody pointed him out, and then they ended up, actually what ended up happening was he got picked up, at a McDonald's, because when he left, he walked, went to Subway, went to Subway, got a soda, went to McDonald's, and asked a kid if he could get him out of there, like, to give him a ride out of there. And little did that kid know that that guy had just shot his sister. So a lot of people don't know that either. So that's one of the three ways that they're going to end. And that's what I tell our guys. I said, they're going to end in one of three ways: suicide, fight us and lose, or get apprehended. That's what it comes down to. But we've done our job of any one of those things. Any one of those three things happen quickly. So our job as ops is to show up quickly. If the mere presence of them seeing us drive in or seeing me run to that building causes them to shoot themselves, I've done my job, because he's no longer shooting innocents. If we draw his fire, I've done my job, because he's no longer shooting innocents. If he leaves, we've done our job, because he's no longer shooting innocents. That's our whole goal. Get there quickly and we let it be known that we're there, because it's going to end in one of three ways. These guys don't plan for confrontations. They just don't think like that. They show up and they're predator, predator, predator until they're not. And that's something to think about a little bit later on. We'll talk about that. That's our most recent stat as far as shootings go. So like I said, these things go back further than Columbine. You can see in there, 91, 84, 86. So before Columbine, again, Columbine was a pivotal one, because we saw that thing develop on TV with all the news helicopters and stuff. But you see in there, everybody's got a number attached to the massacre that's going on. So these guys, they want to beat the last number that was put up. So when Columbine happened, everybody was like, Columbine's the one. They got their name in the paper, all kinds of media. I want to beat them so I can get my name in there. And they started doing that. Numbers started to rise around the nightclub. And then, of course, Vegas, 59. So based off what I just said, somebody out there right now is plotting on how to beat number 59. We're doing our best to prevent that from happening. And in Phoenix, we're doing a whole lot more than just the average. This year, we've done, in the past 3 months, we have done 25. By the end of this week, we'll do 25 active shooter actual scenarios and training at either schools, businesses, or churches. And we've done them from north side to south side, east to west, and hospitals, PCU is coming up, Phoenix Children's is coming up tomorrow. So we're actively doing it, and we're also training and with our fire department. Got those guys on board. Our job is to stop the killing, their job is to save all the lives that have been hurt. So we're bringing them in a lot quicker. It's coming together really good, because everybody knows about that Phoenix fire, police, kind of friendly rivalry, right? Fire, police guys. But we're working together a lot better. It's like cat and dogs working together. We're the dogs. But now we understand what they want. We know what they want from us. We know what they're expecting, just like they know what they're to expect from us. We've also got our dispatchers on board. They designate a channel and 911 lights just for that alone, so that they can get the training too. So it's benefiting everybody. Like I said, we've done roughly, we'll do 25 by the end of this week. So it's working out for all of us. And it benefits everybody else. So it does. So these things, there's no true profile out there. The FBI, famous for profiling, they put a whole bunch of these together and said, we're trying to figure it out. They came up with a white male, age 18 to 55. I'm like, okay, well, that's half the nation. You can't just pick on half the nation. So they said, all right, well, maybe there's some traits that we can start looking at. And they came up with the fact that they're going to be narcissistic and have a love for guns. You just described my SWAT team. That's all you did. So there's no true profile when it comes down to it. Social media, warning signs, those kinds of things is what we start to monitor. And we have a place, it's called Actic, where you can call in complaints and concerns and stuff like that, where all they do is they monitor that kind of stuff. So it's working. So when I say there's no profile, right there, age 8 all the way up to 78. That's the age range. Males, females, kids, adults. It doesn't matter. Anybody can be a shooter, is what it comes down to. The evil plan that those two kids on the left came up with is in Arkansas, 8 and 11, they stole the car, stole the guns from their grandparents and parents, filled their backpacks up with fruit roll-ups and candies and stuff like that. That was a getaway for the next day. They took the rifles, they put them in a tree line that butts up against their fence line to their school. One of them jumps the fence, goes and pulls the fire alarm, runs back, they set up, and as they start firing out, they start shooting. They killed 4 kids and 1 teacher. That's the evil plan that those kids came up with at age 8 and 11. So you can imagine the type of stuff that's out there, right? The one in the middle, you heard the term going postal worker out of San Diego. Six shots, 6 kills, never shot a gun before in her life. And then you got the one on the right, anybody recognize him? Everybody says Vegas. He's ours. He's the one that shot his lawyer, the opposing lawyer, the paralegal, not too long ago, right up the civil and him back. We found him later on with a gun and self-inflicted gunshot wound. What set him off was the fact that it was a dispute over moving furniture, like $30,000. But these things go on. It's not just that set him off. This stuff has been building up. So similar to Broom Bridge. You ever cut somebody off not meaning to, and then they start clipping you off on their own and stuff like that? Well, you cutting them off isn't what set them off. There's a bad day, there's stuff going on in your life. You just happen to be on the front end of doing something that now they're going to take their revenge on. Okay? So it's not like it just snapped. So when they start talking to the neighbors, hey, he was a really good guy, he just snapped. No, he didn't just snap. There's a lot of stuff going on in this person's life. And this is what led up to it. And this was the straw that broke the camel's back. So you start looking at warning signs. People that are antisocial, people that feel like they're the victim. It's me against the world type situation in their mind. They get infatuated with violence. And when I talk about infatuated with it, I'm not talking about, hey, did you see that movie last night? Yeah, that was a good shot. You know, shooter and sniper movie, you know, that was a good shot. No, they're going to go into detail about it. They're going to talk about the blood and guts because that's what they visually see. Okay? Revenge. That one, they feel, like I said, they feel the victim, so they want to get revenge for the injustice that happened to them. So that's why they start turning towards this kind of stuff. Bullying. So, like, even for kids, kids do a lot of drawings. You may have a kid draw 2 cowboys shooting out, but if you get a kid that's drawing 2 cowboys shooting themselves out, but then they start drawing blood and guts and all kinds of other stuff, that's when the concern starts to come in. Okay. Anger and rage. Similar to like a roid rage. It's little things that set them off. A pen that they're not even using, you take off their desk to jot something down real quick, that might set them off. Because in their mind, you're victimizing them again. Just because you feel that you can do it to them. So that might set them off. And then comments about revenge. You get the, hey, don't worry, you're going to get yours. Stuff like that. Comments that fall under that. But again, it's a series of these things. There's a whole bunch of these things that have to be met in order to start looking at this person seriously. Because somebody that just loves violent movies and books, that's not going to fly. Because I love violent movies and books, and I'm not a shooter. Yeah. So it's got to be a few of these things to start meeting that. So I'm going to show you guys a video, and afterwards I'm going to talk in detail about it.
can't get out safely, you need to find a place to hide. Act quickly and quietly. Try to secure your hiding place the best you can. Turn out lights, and if possible, remember to lock doors. Silence your ringer and vibration mode on your cell phone. And if you can't find a safe room or closet, try to conceal yourself behind large objects that may protect you. Do your best to remain quiet and calm. Whether you are alone or working together as a group, fight. Act with aggression. Improvise weapons. Disarm. And commit to taking the shooter down, no matter what. Try to be aware of your environment. Always have an exit plan. Know that in an incident like this, victims are generally chosen randomly. The event is unpredictable and may evolve quickly. The first responders on the scene are not there to evacuate or tend to the injured. They are well trained and are there to stop the shooter. Your actions can make a difference for your safety and survival. Be aware and be prepared. And if you find yourself facing an active shooter, there are three key things you need to remember to survive. Run, hide, fight.
So, run, hide, fight. Now, this is probably your best option if you're not armed. So I know there's a lot of discussion out there in the free world. People talk about, oh, I'm going to be aggressive. And okay, that's fine and dandy, but I can't teach you how to be safe if somebody has a gun and you're trying to be aggressive and this is the distance. Because chances are you're going to get shot. There's nothing I can do or say about that. So, if you're not armed, run, hide, fight is probably your best ABC plan to go with. If you're armed, different story. Now, if you're going to run, you guys know better than anybody where your exits are. So start formulating that plan quick. When you go into work, you guys know where your exits are. Have a backup plan to a backup plan. If your main exit or your closest exit is that front door right there, have a backup to that one. Because if he's coming in, he's coming in through the front door. So know your other exits and how to get to them. Anywhere you go, as far as like restaurants, same concept, start looking for your exits. You know that there's going to be a minimum of two, the front door and the back door. The back door is going to be in the kitchen somewhere. So depending on where you sit, you got to have an exit plan. theaters, same concept. You can see where those are at, okay? Anywhere you go, start looking for your exits. Grocery stores, big doors in the front, and then you know that they got the loading docks in the back. So you know that you can make them to the back or to the front, depending on the situation, you can find an exit. So know where your exits are. That's gonna be one of your biggest things as far as your A, B, and C plan. Then have a backup to that, because if you start running up that exit and it gets shut down by that person, you need to find something else to do. So the way the body works and the mind works is, if you've never been in a high stressful situation, like getting shot at or something, which sucks, you tend to freeze. And the reason you freeze is because you're trying to figure out what's your best course of action to stay alive. So when these things happen, it's going to be fight, flight, or freeze. What you want to do is you want to start formulating a plan, and you want to start visualizing this kind of stuff happening. As dark as it may get, it's going to help you. And the way it's going to help you is it's going to reduce that reaction time that you have. Because if you just act, and then act again if you need to, and then act again if you need to, and you reduce that reaction time, you're better off, as opposed to sitting there like a deer in the headlights trying to figure out what to do. So visualizing this kind of stuff, as dark as it may get, is going to help you. Now when I talk about visualizing this stuff, and when I'm talking about it getting dark, I'm talking to the point where if an active shooter came through that door right now, what would you do? Hopefully they'd be together, right? But if I wasn't here, and you guys were in here, and you came through the door, what would you do? How would you respond? Because your exits aren't here. Hiding underneath the table isn't an option to me. You're just giving up at that point.
That's
so, right. So start visualizing what you would do to them. You know what I mean? Having that kind of plan, if he walked in or you're running out and you see your best friend get shot, how would you react?
Can you try and break the windows?
These kind of windows are meant to withstand a lot. So the movies, taking a chair and hit them, chances are that's not going to happen. Even with window breaks, these kinds of things, window punches, the best you're going to do is put holes in them. I talked to one of our SWAT rangers, and he does this for a living, and he was saying the same thing. He says, yeah, all you can do is just put holes in them. He said, nah, you can weaken the glass at some point, but it's going to take a long, long time. So, but having a plan, right? Hey, exits. Yes? But if you're at your desk, you got somebody else's desk, copy machine, something like that, and say your phone and everything is at your desk, leave your stuff, because the shooter doesn't want your iPhone. And I get it, we're all attached to that thing. It's got our lives in there, right? Food, selfies, cats, pictures, stuff like that, right? The shooter doesn't want that. He wants you. Because remember, he's trying to make the news and he wants that body. So if you have all your stuff at the desk and you're near an exit, all means get out. We'll get you your stuff back, I promise you. Leave whether others are going to follow. Like I said, what's going to happen is fight, flight, or freeze. When people freeze, and you happen to be running out the door, if you can shake them out of it, and take them with you, by all means, do that. But if they're the ones that want to jump underneath the table and just give up, basically, and you're sitting there playing tug-of-war with them, trying to get them to go, that's valuable time that the shooter can find you and them. And I'm sure everybody in here has somebody at the end of the day that wants to see you. So you gotta make that decision. Do I leave or do I continue to fight with this person? And we don't even know the answer. I've said that before. People are like, yeah, I'm leaving. Well, at least you know where you stand in this person's life. So don't attempt to move them. I talked about if you saw your best friend or somebody get shot right in front of you, they go down. I'm talking about somebody who's unconscious, has a cool blood on her arm. Don't move them. The human body is remarkable. I'm sure you guys know this. I've seen a lot of stuff, and I showed up on scene and said, there's no way that person can live. And they live. It's a remarkable thing. Let them stay where they're at, because if you try dragging them into a room and shut the door, that person's going to see that drag mark, and they're going to come back and say, you know what, now that's an easy person, and possibly more than one that's in that room, so I need to get in there, okay? So leave them where they're at. Call us, let us get there as fast as we can, that way we can stop their actions, that way we can get the fire department in there, and let them do what they do best. Prevent others from entering there, that goes without saying, but you may actually have to physically throw something at them or shake those people out of it, because people have earbuds in their ear, right? So they're sitting there on their phone playing Angry Birds or watching some movie, they have their earbuds in. You may have to physically come get them. Don't ignore your gut feeling. This is a big one. The sixth sense thing. We're all born with it. This is your fight flight. This is what tells you to survive. The book right there by Gavin DeBecker, The Gift of Fear. My niece kept my copy. She liked it so much. But that's all it talks about, is the gift of fear, that we don't have it and that we just ignore it. We all have ignored it at some point in time, if not multiple times. Because if it doesn't happen, if nothing happens, so it's right then and there, we just walk away from it and don't say anything. So see something, say something, kind of important. I'll tell you that one of my coworkers says it best. I would rather you think that a stick is a snake and jump, as opposed to the other way around and actually get bit. So if it's something and it concerns you, call us. We have no problem showing up and talking to somebody, especially with the light rail. You guys get a lot of, especially in this area, you guys get a lot of foot traffic around here. If something stands out that you don't think is right, call us. We would rather it be nothing than it be something later on. So we have no problem showing up. But in that book, there's a story in there about a young lady who gets sexually assaulted at gunpoint for 2 hours. And she goes to Gavin because she wants to figure out why it happened, the signs that she missed. And she tells him her story, where she came back from grocery shopping, and as she's walking up to her apartment on the third floor, one of the cans falls out of her bag. She hears some guy at the bottom of the stairs say, hey, don't worry, I'm back. She told Gavin right off the bat, and didn't like his voice. She says, okay. Comes around the corner, says, here you go. He goes, it looks like you got your hands full. Why don't you let me help you? She goes, no, it's okay. And he goes, are you sure? Because you probably don't lose more food or something like that. And, you know, I can help you. I'm going out the same direction. She goes, no, it's okay. And he continues on. He presses her. Well, now she feels guilty. She feels guilty for the fact that here's some guy just trying to be nice to her. And she's being rude is what she thinks. I told my family, be rude. Probably never see that person again. Oh, well, if you do, be rude if you don't like it. They get her to her apartment. She cracks open the door. She says, thank you. He says, I can take the bag in for you. She goes, no, it's okay. And he goes, yeah, he goes, the counter's right there. He goes, you can leave the door open. 2 hours later, okay, he's getting dressed. He goes over to her window and he shuts her window. Why do you think he would do that? Because of the noise that the gun might make, she might make. He turns around and tells her, I'm gonna let you go. He goes, I'm gonna go get something to drink first. He goes, and then when I come back, he goes, I'll let you go. He goes, but until then, he goes, you stay right there. Down there. So for her, it didn't either. She wrapped herself in a sheet, and as he walks out of her bedroom, she basically follows him. He goes into the kitchen, she goes out the front door, but she tells Gavin, on my way out the front door, she goes, I hear him going through my kitchen doors. I think he was doing that. With a fire and a gun, right? Well, luckily for her, she knew that her neighbors across the way, they always kept the door open, or unlocked. It's California, I don't know why. But she gets in there, locks the door, calls the police, they catch him. Come to find out this guy's been doing this before, and they believe he was starting to amp up his crimes because they think she's going to be his first killer. But she paid attention to that red flag. Saved her life. If she hadn't done that, we wouldn't have known that. So pay attention to the red flags. If it bothers you, call us. We have no problem showing up. Okay? So, you're going to hear me touch on this probably a couple of times. And that's if you happen to be running out the building, or you come in contact with us at any point in time like that, we want to see your hands. Keep them up high, spread your fingers, and let us see that you got nothing in your hands. Because for us, we don't know anybody that is here. We don't know who's involved or what's going on. So when we start showing up and we see people running towards us, we want to make sure you got nothing in your hands. Because otherwise, we're going to start dealing with you appropriately, okay? We're going to have our hands. And when we see stuff in people's hands, it worries us. And that's one of the reasons why we're there. That gun is no bigger than this. All you do is flip it open and you millimeter. They even made that gun to make it look like it's a cell phone, because it's got a little design back there to make it look like a camera, and it comes with a belt clip so you can wear it on your belt. So, for reasons like that, you have a cell phone in your hand, and we tell you to drop it. I get it, $1,000 iPhone, they break it really easy. Get yourself a Samsung. I take a pee. I drop mine almost every day now. But that's the reason why. You can't have anything in your hands, okay? We don't want to see anything in your hands. If it's a phone or whatever, you don't want to break it, just ask it's a phone, it's a phone, it's a phone, start putting it down real quick, okay? Now, if you can't get out of the building, find a good place to barricade yourself in. It says hide, but in my mind, a hide is a room that you can barricade. Something that you can throw furniture at to prevent somebody from opening that door. Hopefully it's out of the sight of the shooter. And making it cover over concealment. Cover stops a bullet. Concealment just hides my body. So like sheetrock walls, I can shoot them. But you put me behind a solid core door, solid core table, filing cabinet, you put all that stuff together and you stack it up. By the time that bullet goes through that door, through all that other stuff, it's not gonna make it. It's just the way ballistics work. So if you can get behind something that's gonna stop a bullet, it doesn't have to be just one thing like a brick wall. It could be a layer of stuff to make it happen. Since you don't want to hide a trap, well, if you have an exit door, then you probably should take the exit door. But if not, then a good hide is gonna trap you. You should barricade that thing in because it's buying you time. That person knows that they're on the clock when they pull that trigger. They know that. Somebody's calling 911 and we are on the way. So they know that they got a minimal amount of time to beat number 59. And I guarantee you it's not gonna happen in Phoenix. Locking the door to prevent the shooter from entering. If the doors have locks, then by all means, yes. Use them and then barricade that stuff up. The shooter at Virginia Tech, he was going up and down the hallways. And what he was doing was any room that was open, he went in, shot everybody, left, went into another room, shot everybody, and then he'd come back out and he'd go back into the room he just left and reshoot them. Any door he came across that was locked, he just bypassed it, checked it, walked away. Because they want easy targets. They don't want something they have to fight. So that's probably the only thing that they have in common with common criminals, is the fact that they don't want to have to fight for this stuff. They want it to come easy. So if you put something up that makes them have to fight through it, chances are they're not going to do it. Unless they're looking for somebody specific. So similar to like what we had in Phoenix back in the early 90s, strange husband shows up and he wants his wife's address. They won't give it to him. He says, okay, he leaves, he comes back with a 45 caliber handgun and shoots up clerk. I want to say it was 9 times, but somebody said it was 12. Either way, 9 times is a lot for that size of caliber gun. And one of those bullets lodged in her heart. She lived. Remarkable, right? Remarkable why. He ended up killing her supervisor and wounding another one. So I say he's looking for somebody specific, but that day, they happen to catch the front end of his anger. So ideas. Throw stuff up together. This guy is actually, he's actually got a tie around that door, and he's off to the side just holding it, so it prevents it from opening. You could probably use tables. If you come across a door like this, use those tables in a better way, because that door actually opens out. Just by looking at it, it opens out, so all that guy's gonna do is open the door and then it's gonna be furniture. So what you can do is take that table, put it down the side, up against the door frame, wrap something around the table, something to the door handle, and then it prevents that wedge again. Okay? That thing at the bottom that was made for, I wanna say $1.40, a teacher in Ohio came up with that, went to Home Depot. And then you got that device up top. For the retractables, it slides right over and it prevents it from expanding. Anything that keeps that from expanding will keep that door from opening. I think that thing sells for like $85. Me and my old sergeant that used to do this, we were talking about coming up with something like that. And if we had acted on it, I wouldn't be here right now. I'd be in the mountains somewhere sipping on something. But it's in here, right?
I saw something like that where they took old fire hose.
kind of stuff you have to think outside the box. There is no cookie cutter, because if there was, I'd give it to you, you'd be safe for the rest of your life. But unfortunately, it's just not the way life works. So you have to think outside the box when it comes to this kind of situation. So if you're blocking stuff up, again, heavy furniture, turn everything off within reason. If the shooter's next or close around, you're going to know it, because the shot's going to be a lot louder than if he was on the other side of the building where it's going to sound muffled. Turn everything off if you need to. Cell phones, computer screens, lamps, radios, you name it, turn everything off and make it look like it's unoccupied. You don't want to bring any attention to yourself. Hiding behind large cabinets, desks, it's the same concept as barricading the door and then just getting behind everything. If you can move that stuff up against the door, even better. So hopefully you can lock a door and then get behind something that's going to stop a bullet. Try to remain as quiet as possible. You guys saw in the video where that one girl was kind of frantic in that room. They just stuck her in the corner. I was doing one of these for a behavioral place. And it was a group of probably 70, 80. And the age range was 18 to roughly 85. The oldest lady even raises her hand and says, "Hey, if I'm in there and I'm getting somebody like that, is it okay for me to just haul off and knock her out?"
Yeah.
I said, I'm like, you're thinking outside the box. I can't tell you to do that. You know, she'll probably thank you through a broken nose or something later on that you saved her life. But thinking outside the box. But you got to try to remain as quiet as possible. That's what it comes down to. Safe rooms. You can turn a room into a safe room. Find something that's good that you can turn into a safe room. Reinforcing stuff. I did one of these for a lawyer's office. And their thing was, their break room is what they were going to do. They had a door over there, a door over here. They were going to take that door out shut it down and put the lock, and then this side they were reinforcing the door. And in there for their break room, of course, it's lawyers, so they have curing machines, refrigerated, running water. The only thing they didn't have was a bathroom, so I told them to get buckets. Hopefully they're not in there that long, right? But stuff happens. Call your 911 when possible. That means when you're safe. Again, you don't want to draw any attention to you. I would rather you be safe and not call us and be somewhere hiding, and when we show up, you're fine, as opposed to trying to get to us and give you this information and getting that person drawn to you, okay? I would rather that. So just make sure you're safe as possible. If you're away from the building, you're away from the building. If you're inside and you're hiding and the shots are going off somewhere else and you can call us, then by all means call us. If the shots get closer, don't try to whisper. Cell phones they'll give you away, okay? Especially if you have lights off and everything, the light from those cell phones are bright. I mean, we use them in the dark, right? So that kind of stuff. So don't try to whisper. It'll be like that movie Taken. "Excuse me, please hurry, please hurry." Leave the light open for dispatch. Now this is an option. The way the phone systems work is with a landline, if you call 911, it's going to come to this building. So you don't have to say anything other than dial 911. And if you want to hang up the phone, you can. Or you can leave it off the hook. You leave it on the hook, that's intelligence for us, because our dispatchers are very good at what they do. And if they're training with us, they know exactly what we're looking for. So if you dial 911, leave the receiver off the hook, she's going to listen to that. Automatically, she's going to dispatch a couple of officers here. In the background, she's going to hear what's going on. Shots fired, screaming and yelling. Now she's going to ask for more officers, because now we can kind of guess what it's going to be. So we'll send more officers. So it's intelligence for us. If you were to put the receiver back on the hook, we're still going to send a minimum of two officers here. Only because it's a 911 hangup, and we're going to find out why we got hung up on it. With cell phones, it's different. Cell phones, because they use repeaters, I can get only a general area of where you're at. Now, the way that works is because cell phone companies hate us, they make us jump through a lot of hoops. So in order for me to find out where you're at or where you're calling from, I would have to get your cell phone number, put it in an affidavit, draw up a search warrant, get it signed by a judge, and then serve on the cell phone company just to get your location. But then it's over. So with cell phones, if you're going to call or text, because we can text in our opinions, send me a location or send my dispatcher's location. Bare minimum. That's all we need to start with, because we're going to send officers. So bare minimum, just to give me a location. If you want to dial 911, say where you're at or location. This is going to be your last resort. You're barricaded up, and that person, for whatever reason, wants to get in that room. This is where it's going to get ugly, and you've got to get aggressive. There is no 50% in this. Because remember, this person has a weapon, and they want to kill you. That's what their goal is. So you have to be aggressive. You have to turn the tables on them. Right now, they're a predator, and you're the prey. You got to flip that. You got to turn that around and get aggressive, get ugly. And when I'm talking about ugly, I'm talking about that dark switch that you, that everybody's got. You just got to fight. Because again, they're trying to hurt you. They're trying to kill you, okay? It'd be dumb for me to say, to stand on the opposite side of the room while they're trying to break through, because in order for you to get aggressive, you have to be close to that door, because when they reach that door, you have to be there for it, okay? So hopefully you're in a room with like-minded people where you guys want to live, and you guys have come up with a plan to take that person. And when you come up with a plan, keep it simple. It's like I told my daughter years ago. I said, anybody ever attacks you, keep it simple. Eyes, throat. I use colorful words with my daughter. I never shout at her. But we'll say groin. And I told her this a long time ago, when she was about 13, I told her, I'm from a small town. And I went back home to go see her, and I told her, I said, anybody ever attacks you? Eyes, throat, and groin. And then I said, I'm going to show you now. I said, well, when you go for the eyes, I said, what I want you to do is I want you to go knuckle deep on your thumbs. I said, scoop from inside to outside. I said, now probably not going to scoop out their eyes, it's because of the way anatomy is. I said, but if you do, send me a picture and twist it like that. I know that it works. If you go for the throat.
Yeah, in terms of fighting, what's the best reality-based self-defense?
Probably Krav Maga, because they're pretty violent.
Krav Maga.
Yeah, they're pretty violent. And that's what I like, because I don't believe in fight. A fight is never a fight in the streets. You know what I mean? So, but if you're going to go for the throat, then I want your fingers to touch. Make that fingertips touch. And if you're going to go for the groin, if you can't hit, kick, or punch it, treat it like fruit. Grab, twist, and pull as hard as you can. That's what I told her. So she ends up calling me midweek that week. I come back up to work. She calls me midweek. She's like, Dad, the school resource officer was at the school today. And guess what the topic was? If you get attacked, what would you do? I start shaking my head because I can see a little bit going down. Yeah. And sure enough, I was like, so what happened? She goes, I raised my hand, they called on me, and I go, what'd you say? And she goes, I said, eyes, throat. And she said, yeah, use the word that I use. And I just shook my head. And I go, did she get in trouble? She goes, no. She goes, school resource officer, just ask what you did for a living. I told her you were a pop up in Phoenix, and they said, oh, well, that makes all the sense. So be aggressive, make it ugly, okay? But you can't 50% this thing. You can throw items at them to distract them. Depending on the situation too. You can even do that as you're running out. So if you're running and you run the corner and now we're this close, whatever I have in my hand is what I'm gonna probably throw at you. And it doesn't take much, because if you think about it, if I were to take my cell phone, $1,000 cell phone, or even a thing of napkins, and I threw them towards your face, what's your natural reaction to it? Because you don't know what it is, you're gonna do a minimum with that, right? You're gonna get a flinch. If I get you to flinch, I own you. Because I'm that close and now you're mine. And that's the way you've got to think. You're now mine because you tried to kill me. You should have that mentality of you had the audacity to come to my place of work and try to kill me. That's not gonna fly. Now you gotta pay for it. So that's the way you should think. So similar to there, you know, you got people in there with made up weapons, improvised weapons, a chair, coffee pot. I've never used a belt like that before. When I was growing up, it was used for two things: keeping up your pants and then filling the burnt end up. So fire extinguishers, good weapons. People have asked me before if I were to spray them with a fire extinguisher and then hit them with it, would that be okay? Depending on the fire extinguisher, it might. There's a lot of different ones out there that spit out different stuff. If they're anything like what Phoenix carries in our patrol cars, then I suggest not to, because that is a fine cloud and a fine dust that comes out of those things. I know that because one of them set off in my trunk and all my stuff was covered in there. So it took me a good long time to get that out.
You can use a pencil to
that. Oh yeah, we'll get that. But yeah, I would rather just get it with it. Just hit them with it. Be on the safe side, just hit them with it. But you see on there too, you hot coffee. Throw hot coffee in somebody's face, salt, if you've ever had salt in your eyes, that stings too. Napkins, again, it's that extraction, and then I open into some weirdos on the river there, and she wanted me to send her my expendable baton. We don't carry those anymore because we carry tasers. And I said, yeah, sure. But instead, what I did is I sent her, they call it a tactical pen. And it's a titanium pen. One side writes, the other side has a really sharp point. You get them on Amazon for like 15 bucks. I sent her one of those. And she calls back and she goes, what am I supposed to do with this? Get the guy my autograph after he's done? So I said, okay. I said, look. I said, I know you. I said, I love you with all my heart. I said, but if I gave you my expandable, I said, I know what's going to happen. You're going to expand it, look really cool, and then they're going to take it away from you and beat you. I said, so I need you to have something that you can control. So I go, I want you to take that sharp point. I go, and I want you to drive it on top of your knuckle. I go, tell me you wouldn't open your hand. She goes, hold on, look. She goes, it hurts. I said, okay. I said, put it somewhere else on. I said, up your forearm. She said, okay. I said, now let's get a little bit more violent. Stick it underneath your chin. She goes, no, I know it's going to hurt. I said, okay. I said, what about somebody's cheekbone? So drive it up. She goes, oh, I know it hurts. I go, now think about going into somebody's eye. Underneath somebody's ear, in their ear. I said, can you do that? I said, because I don't need you to kill this person. I need you to get away. I go, hey, you're gouging somebody's eyes, grabbing their throat, or using a pen on them. I go, and you're causing that much pain? What are they not thinking about? They're not thinking about shooting you anymore. They're thinking, I walk into the wrong room, mess with the wrong person, and now I gotta get out of here because this sucks. A lot of pain. So if you take something sharp and put it into something soft, I guarantee you it changes people's attitudes. Sharpie markers, they work great. Oh, and about those pens too, if you fly a lot, TSA will let you fly with them because they write. As long as you prove it right, you take them with you. So all that stuff you can use. When I was on patrol, we would carry the black, what are they, paper make paint pens with the caps. We take them before our shift and we turn them upside down, uncap them, put them back in our shirts like they were capped pens. But we had a plan. When I talk about plans, A, B, C, C's, that was our last ditch effort. If we got into a fight and I couldn't get anything on my belt, then I had to use the pen and stab somebody with just to get away, then by all means, that was a last ditch effort. But we had a plan. So that's something important to have. So when we respond, we're going directly to that threat. We're looking for that person. So that means we're going to bypass anything and everybody. So you may be injured, people may be hurt, we don't take it lightly. We, contrary to what some people think, we actually got into this job to help people. And to bypass somebody who needs our assistance, we don't take lightly. I saw a debrief on an officer that was at a South Carolina active shooter there at the church. Happened a few years back. He went into that church and then there was a young man shot in the chest and was reaching out for him asking for help. He says, I'll be right back. I've got to make sure that he's not here no more. By the time he got back, that kid had expired. That officer was on the job for 3 years. He took a leave of absence, got his master's in engineering, and he's no longer a cop. But he lives with that every day. And you can tell that when he talks about it to this day, he still loves it. So we don't take it lightly. We understand that we got to do what we got to do, but we're going to try and come back and help you as quickly as possible. So we don't take it lightly. So we bypass everything. We've got to do police stuff first. After that, once we've dealt with the shooter, anybody that we come across, if you can walk, we're going to take you to a designated area that we deem safe ourselves. Like almost like a rally. We're going to take you over there, and we're going to call you safe. And we're going to have officers around you, officers escorting you. So we'll be setting up an evacuation route. Now, when we do that, I may walk with you, with the whole line, or I may just pass you off to the next officer. And tell you, see that officer over there, you're gonna walk straight to him. When we do that, we're gonna have you with your hands either high, on top of your head, or on the person in front of you. Okay? That's what we're gonna be looking for. Because again, we can't see everybody's hands because we don't know who's involved in this. So similar to like the Pulse nightclub shooting. That guy's wife was involved. How she got off on conspiracy charges, I'll never know because she was with him when they staked it out. She knew exactly what he was gonna do. She just didn't pull the trigger, but how she got off, I'll never know. 80% of the people, or 80% of the shootings that actually happen, at least one person knew of their plans. So see something sensitive, it's kind of important. So we'll find a route, we'll walk you out of it. Now, if we happen to be walking by your desk, and there's your cell phone with your selfies and food and stuff like that, and you reach for it, you're going to get a gun pointed at you. So don't do that. Listen to us. We're going to tell you what to do, when to do it, and how to you out. If that's something that you need, just tell us, we will get it for you. Okay? So similar to that, hands up top of your head, that kind of stuff. We're gonna come back in and we're gonna start looking for hikers. Anybody who's barricaded in rooms and doors and stuff like that, we're gonna go get those and we're gonna start letting you know that we're here and you can open the door now. I've been asked the question, well, how do we know that that's not the shooter trying to coax us out? Fair enough. If you have cell phones or something like that, we'll try and get with our dispatchers so that we can work something out so you can open the door. If not, I've gone as far as before taking off my badge and you can get my commission card and slide them underneath the door just so that they can open it. We'll prove it out one way or another. If that doesn't get you to open the door, it now becomes our SWAT team's issue because it is no longer you guys hiding. There's something else going on here and we're going to find out why. Okay? But at the end of the day, I'm getting my badge and my card back. I promise you that. If you need first aid while we're doing this, let us know. Just because you can walk out on your own doesn't mean that everything's okay. So chest pains, anxiety attack, boxing, you need something like that, let us know. We'll take you to fire. You may have a bullet hole that you don't even know about until we get out there. So if that's the case, let us know. Adrenaline dumps. So these things develop quickly. You saw in that video how fast that guy was able to take out a shotgun and start working that action. He, in all reality, fired 5 rounds in roughly 5 to 6 seconds. Okay. So they develop quickly. So that visualization, having that plan of what you're going to do when something like this kicks off, kind of real. That'll shrink down your freeze time. Okay? So visualize this stuff. Have it. Cover that. Try to remain calm. Screaming and yelling isn't going to do make the situation any better, especially when we show up. All you're going to do is draw our attention to you when we should be looking for somebody that needs our attention in all reality, which is the shooter or somebody that they're working with. Okay? So try to remain calm. Get it. It's probably going to be the most stressful time in your life ever. You may have seen some ugly. We got to still do our job, okay? So just follow our instructions and keep an eye out for anything suspicious. If we happen to be walking you guys out, and because we bypassed so much stuff to get to that shooter, you happen to see a black backpack with a pipe and a phone and wires hanging out of it, FBI calls that up to let us know. Okay. Anybody related to that guy? And what had the girls say yes? It was right when the FBI agent did flip. You shot somebody in the crowd. I don't know if you saw that video. Happened like probably a couple months ago. And then I reminded her of that. And I said, yeah, go get the Five Phoenix to do that. Again, keep your hands visible at all times, raise fingers. Don't be offended if we search you, because it's probably going to happen. We got to make sure that everybody's safe, because if we take you to a location that we've called safe, and then all of a sudden another shooter happens because we didn't search anybody, that's on us. Okay, so we're probably going to search you. Don't get offended by that, because again, we don't know anybody. When we get here, we don't know anybody. But that right there, that gun, is a full-size Glock that's collapsible, and it's as big as my phone. It's about this big. And it's a full-size one of these Glock 19s. So, there's a company that makes them, for whatever reason, but they're a lot more concealable. Okay? So, we can't have anything in your hands. Avoid trying to make a quick movement towards us. We understand this may be one of them. It's probably the only time that you probably have to see a cop when we show up to one of these things. And you want to hug us and tell us thank you. Don't do it right then and there. At the end of this, we will give you all the hugs you want. I promise you. But not right then and there, because sympathetic reflex is a true thing for us. And similar to that picture, if that officer pulls that trigger and shoots that little girl, that's on that officer. Whatever comes out of my barrel, to me. It doesn't matter what. If I pull that trigger and I hit an innocent, one, that's going to probably screw me up for a little while in my head. But two, I own it. That's on me. I should know better. It doesn't matter what was going on. Okay? So don't jump on us. So if you're able to call 911, again, our dispatchers are very good. In Phoenix, what you guys should do is give a location and what's going on if you can. After that, let our dispatchers take over the conversation. They're going to prompt you for what we need as responding officers. Okay? Now, if you're outside the city of obviously, of where this is happening. Number of shooters, kind of important for us, because if you tell us it's one, we're coming with a theory that there's two. If you tell us there's two, we're coming with a theory that there's three. Now, if you start off with a number of 10, that's a lot more than what we expect, and this is no longer just an active shooter. This is something else. So the city is coming. Okay? Not that we're not going to set the city other way, but mentally it's going to prepare us for the fight of our lives. Description of the shooters helps, because again, we don't know anybody who's there. We don't know anybody when we show up. So if you give me a description of a 16-year-old white male wearing a dark shirt and tan jeans, then when I show up and I enter the building, I enter any room, that's what I'm looking for. And if it doesn't fit that description, I'm on to the next. It's a process of elimination for us when we do this. I used that description in one of mine, and there happened to be a 16-year-old boy that fit the description I was just talking about. I was like, sorry, dude. You're probably the one that I deal with right now. Number and type of weapons. I don't need you to tell me that it's a Glock 19, bullets 15 in the magazine, one on the pipe. Because if you can do that based off the shots themselves, you're awesome. I can't do that. That's been a long time behind the trigger. What I need though is it a handgun, a rifle, sword, knife, all of the above. Let us know that. If you never see the shooter and you never see the gun, then err on the side of caution for us and just tell us it's a rifle. Tell us it's a rifle, a long gun, something like that, because we're going to come expecting the worst of it. That way we can prepare for it and we can deal with it. Number of potential victims. If you're in a hide and you haven't seen it, just say yes, people are shot, people are hurt. Just say that, because that way we can get fired here a lot quicker, because somebody is going to be hurt. I can guarantee you that in this situation. Somebody's going to be hurt or need medical attention. And what I mean by that is possibly heart attack or something like that case, right? So just say it. Get fire rolling, because our dispatchers have to get on fire dispatchers to get them dispatched here. So just tell them and say yes. They'll wait for us, we'll show up, and we'll bring them as quickly as possible. Any supervisors that have access to everything, we're gonna look and seek you guys out at some point in time, because we're gonna want to know what doors are locked, why they're locked, if you guys have medical supplies in a room or something like that before our SWAT team actually reaches it, because they like to use things that go bang. We would rather it just does that as opposed to go boom. City kind of frowns on us destroying buildings, so hazards. Medication, that kind of stuff, we're treated a little bit different when we start hitting those rooms. So we'll find you, we'll look for you, and we'll figure out what we can do with that. Any doors, exit points, we understand that remodeling happens. So where there used to be a door, there may not be one now, it may be somewhere else. We were looking at a map on one of our things just last week, and the map said that there was a door right there, and I looked at it, and there was a wall. So it's a little worried that door. Doesn't exist anymore, okay? But that's the kind of stuff that we like to know, because if we come across a map, that's what we'll generally use. So one thing that you could do as far as helping us out is get a current layout of the building and have just floor plan maps, maybe with keys in there, that we can access any room for us and just have it in the bag somewhere when we shop, something like that. See if you can work something out with your HR, your supervisors, maybe coming in late, going home early on certain days, avoid your appointment in the morning. I said, if somebody comes into my day, I said, it's the human element that I'm worried about. I want to be prepared for that. At least give me a fighting chance. That's the way I look at it. If you're going to shoot at me, at least let me get a shot off too. That's the way I think, because I think I'm better. So have a plan. Have a backup plan. To a backup plan. Anywhere you go, you should be thinking about exits. You can spot any cop in any restaurant, because we sit with our backs to the wall, facing the front door. G-Shock watch, open glasses, and a high haircut, right? Greasy spot. You guys should be thinking like that. I should be finding an area I can sit at, hopefully, where I can see what's going on in front of me, and if I need to, I can exit at some point in time. So, thinking like that, having that type of plan, it's not that you're being prepared. It's not that you're worried about it. It's just that you're being prepared. If you're prepared, your reaction time is a lot smaller when it comes down to it, and you can probably save your life. A lot of people are oblivious to their work, to the world. California Corrections did a study, and they were showing videos, and they're saying, and they had a bunch of inmates, and they said, which ones would you make victims, and which ones would you not? want somebody who can ID us. We don't want somebody who could fight us, somebody who's waiting for it. When you make eye contact with people, nowadays it just doesn't happen a lot. People put their head down, they walk by, hiking, that kind of stuff. You walk by people with your head down. Make eye contact with people. Because if they're thinking about attacking you and you make that eye contact, you've done two things. One, you've just humanized yourself. And now it's in their mind that you're an actual human being. And now it's a little bit harder to deal with that. Two, you can ID them. And they don't want that. They don't want somebody who pays attention. So little things like that can save a lot of hassle in your life. Okay? And you understand our response and what we're going to do, bypass everything. When you get contacted by us, hands, right? And then have an emergency action plan. Okay? Have it for your personal life. Have it for your work life. Have it anywhere you go. Know your exits. Right? Be aggressive. Any questions?
For home help, when we're going into patients' houses, it's a little bit harder because it's almost like a cat and mouse kind of game because you don't know them, their family, or even the neighbors, especially with apartments that can sometimes get sketchy. What do you feel is our best option in terms of like an emergency action plan? Because if we're there in that moment, let's say they have a grandson or somebody who's coming into the house and is violent in that case, because we also, I know we are supposed to always protect the patients, but then the tricky thing is if the patient is the one who's the aggressor, and then like our policies and everything about not harming our patients, but also trying to protect ourselves and the fight or flight. What would you do in that situation or advise us to do? Just survival, you know, that kind of a deal? Or?
One thing I don't want to do is I don't want to pull against you guys' policies. Mm-hmm. But with that being said, if I get attacked, all bets are off. That's what I'm thinking. Mm-hmm. It's my survival now. And it's me getting out as best as I can. And if that means I gotta take my pen and stab you in the leg or, you know, stab you in the neck, whatever the case may be, to get you to that front door and get you out of there, then that's what I'm gonna do. Because I'm pretty sure I could find another job somewhere else if they fire me. Yeah. But I don't have another life. Mm-hmm. So that's the way I look at it. Yeah. And like I said, I can't give you like too much legal stuff.
No, I know. That's the tough part about home. You don't know what houses you're going into, you don't know the people, especially if it's not even the house itself, but just in the neighborhood.
Right.
Like, that's the tough part. I was like, good question.
Yeah, have a plan. Have a plan in every, you know that most houses are going to have two exits. And if everybody's in that front room, or your front room is locked up, know where that exit door is at. Mm-hmm. Carry a pen every single time.
Yeah.
Those are just fine. What do you have a pen? Did I write with it?
Keys work too.
Keys do work. They do. But, I mean, they make a lot of different stuff, you know, for that protocols. But pens are easiest to be able to justify. People carrying, I don't know if they're called coupons. They're basically, I don't know, it's got three sides, almost where you have two forks sticking out and then one at the bottom. People carry those on their knees. That's meant for one thing. That's meant for self-defense and self-defense only.
Like the brass knuckles through those spikes on?
Similar to that. But it'd be hard to justify carrying that kind of stuff when you're at work and you showed up and you're carrying that kind of stuff. But you can always justify carrying a pen, right? Have it under your hand, you can always justify the pen. So that's why, you know, when it comes to offices and places that you can't carry, pens are your best option. That's what I look at. That's why I say, when I did one of these for the churches and I brought up that tactical pen, father ended up buying 15 for his staff. Mm-hmm. I was told they wanted, so that they could have them. Good for you. You can justify a pen, you can't justify a Kubota or a switchblade, you know what I mean? Mm-hmm. So that's what I said.